Good evening.
Who said that?
That was very polite. Yeah, wasn't it? Well done. Good evening and welcome to the BHA's Holyoake Lecture of 2016. My name's Andrew Copson, I'm the Chief Executive of the British Humanist Association. Our Holyoake Lecture is held every year as part of our annual lecture series, specifically to explore political thought as it relates to contemporary humanism, on secular, therefore, on humanist issues and more broadly. This is our biggest ever Holyoake Lecture since it started just a couple of years ago, so give yourself a round of applause. Woo! Holyoake, for those of you who don't know him, was the 19th century author and political activist who coined the word secularism. Although he was born in the Midlands, he spent a lot of his time in the north.
Correct.
And, yes, well, I'm from the Midlands. Owen's from London, as you know. And he is recognised not just as one of the founders of the humanist movement, but also of the cooperative movement in the UK. And in that, he was an Owenite. Possibly the classiest segue that ever has existed in a BHA lecture. Because I'm very happy to be able to introduce, as our lecturer, Holyoake lecturer this evening, Owen Jones. It's a great pleasure to be able to do so, and to look forward, as you all are, to the topic of his talk this evening towards the humanist politics. Because Owen and I first met over a decade ago, when we were both undergraduates, in happier political times, in many ways. And it's a great pleasure to see him again. I welcome him to the podium, as of course do all of you. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Andy. What he didn't mention, I'm going to mention it now, is we first met with duct tapes on our mouths. Now, that might sound a bit odd, without any context. We were protesting about the introduction of tuition fees and the silencing of students, so it wasn't anything kinky. Right, it's an honour to be here. It's an honour to be in Manchester, the capital of the North. Not normally heckled for that in Manchester. Interesting, heckled, 15 seconds in? Blimey, it's going to be a long evening. But it is an honour to be back in Manchester with the weather as ever to welcome me back. But it's an honour to be here, it's an honour to be invited by you, by obviously all of you humanists, and hopefully, I'm going to talk and we're going to have a fascinating discussion. I'm very much looking forward to hear your own contributions. So I will begin. Now, this speech is a defence of humanist values in politics at a time when they're under siege. On the eve of World War I, the then British Foreign Secretary, Sir Edward Grey, is reported to have said, "The lamps are going out all over Europe. We shall not see them again in our lifetime." Now, it would be an exaggeration to say, today they are going out, but you can certainly see them flickering. If you are a believer in democracies that entrench the rights of minorities, in diversity rather than conformity, in the well-being of all humanity as our ultimate ambition and endpoint, in liberating human potential from political, economic, and social constraints, then it is better to currently feel discomfort rather than complacency. Across the Atlantic, in the world's last superpower, a white nationalist demagogue spouting misogyny, bigotry and racism is one of the main two contenders for the presidency. Now, Donald Trump may be vanquished in November's election, but the circumstances that led to his ascendancy from the racism, which is the legacy of slavery, to the rampant economic insecurity that defines the lives of millions of Americans. Trumpism, with or without Trump, will surely survive even an expected election round, and perhaps find a candidate with more credibility. Trump's this demagogue, he darkly warns of a rigged election and weaves the classic stabbed-in-the-back narrative of the fascist right. This in a country already awash with both right-wing conspiracy theories and guns. His campaign's legacy could threaten the stability of the United States and further menace the women and minorities he has so deliberately and remorselessly targeted in the course of his sordid campaign. And here in Europe, for the first time since Adolf Hitler swallowed cyanide, Austria's far right is a serious contender for power. In France, the inheritors of the mantle of Vichy thrive. The far right National Front are all but guaranteed to win the first round of the French presidential elections. In Sweden, the icon of European social democracy, a party that emerged from a white supremacist movement, repeatedly tops the polls. In austerity-ravaged Greece, the neo-Nazi Golden Dawn feed on a nation's anguish and terrorises minorities. Hungary is ruled by a right-wing authoritarian prime minister who boasts of building an illiberal democracy, in his own words, and sends dogs to chase refugees who have already fled unspeakable horror. Some of his opponents are even less palatable, like Jobbik, a neo-fascist party which speaks of Jewish conspiracies and has around 20% of the support of the population. In Poland too, democracy is threatened by an authoritarian right-wing government. Even in Germany, long seen as immune to mass right-wing populism in post-war Europe, the self-described alternative for Germany is on the march. Research by YouGov suggests that authoritarian anti-immigrant nationalism has captured the imagination of hundreds of millions of Europeans. And then there's a wider global picture. China's dictatorship and Russia's regime flaunt a foreign policy which rejects democratic values. Saudi Arabia decapitates its citizens for being gay or for dissenting against the ruling tyranny. It exports a brand of fundamentalist Islamist extremism which menaces the Middle East and threatens our own national security. It rains Western-supplied bombs on Yemen's civilian populations. Calamitous Western military interventions in Iraq and Libya have led to mass slaughter, the displacement of millions, violent sectarianism, chaos, and the rise of religious extremism. Syria's agony has sent tides of human misery hurtling over its borders. The world's problems differ in scale and specifics from our own. But it is self-evident that Britain is currently in the midst of its greatest crisis since the end of World War II. On June the 23rd, millions of decent fellow Britons marched to the polling station and they voted to leave the European Union. What I say here is not an attack on Leave voters, however much the malign and the deceitful portrayed as such, any more than a criticism of the woeful official Remain campaign is a smear on the character of Remain voters. The Leave campaign made a strategic decision to turn a referendum on the European Union into a referendum on immigration. In doing so, they offered a toxic mixture of bigotry and lies. Immigrants were portrayed as criminals, rapists, and murderers. Turkey will not join the European Union in the lifetime of anyone in this room. And yet, Britain's voters were told otherwise, and that this country's fictional accession would allow Turkish criminals to swamp through our borders. Nigel Farage, he stood in front of a poster of dark-skinned refugees fleeing violence beyond Europe's borders. The words "breaking point" were inscribed upon it. In the aftermath of the referendum, recorded hate crimes soared by 41%. And that's just reported. I've been inundated by the personal experiences of people abused in the streets because of their nationality, religion, or the colour of their skin, often by those who purport to have a mandate for their hatred. Very few of them told me that they had told the police. Britain's near future threatens to be defined by convulsions and the economic grievances that helped spur on the Leave vote in the first place may only worsen. Rising inflation points to a return to the protracted squeeze in living standards that we've suffered in the last few years. The scapegoats are ready. Damn the unpatriotic Ramoners and their plot to subvert the will of the British people, screeches the Daily Mail, Britain's second most read newspaper. Time to silence EU exit whingers, bellows the front page of the Daily Express. Stuart Jackson, a Tory Member of Parliament, serving in the government's Brexit department, calls on UK patriots to boycott The Economist, because of the magazine's liberal smugness, Ramona whinging, and rampant Europhilia. One local Tory council even began a petition demanding that support for the European Union be made a treasonable offence. Now, such attacks do not betray confidence on the part of the victors. If they believed a bright and stable future beckoned, why such fury on those on the losing side? And so millions of people are dismissed as saboteurs, wreckers, fifth columnists, the enemy within. These are not symptoms of a healthy, properly functioning democracy. It should frighten us. Let's not forget how the alleged murderer of the humanist Labour Member of Parliament, Joe Cox, entered his name in court. Death to traitors, freedom for Britain. There is a need for a politics of humanism, and it is urgent. As humanists, we believe that this is the only world that we have. We do not have faith in the existence of another world beyond our own. Free of the injustice, the hatred, the oppression, the violence that so scars our own. That is what compels us, what drives us to rid our planet of misery and to build societies that unlock the full potential and maximises the well-being of humanity as a whole. The value of life lies not in its length, but in the use we make of it, said Michel de Montaigne. We do not believe any other force can achieve such a goal other than humanity itself. We believe that human beings are social animals, that we are interdependent, that we succeed or fail together. As humanists, we believe that democracy does not mean, as John Stuart Mill puts it, the tyranny of the majority. We believe in the protection of the rights of minorities, even if this is an unpopular cause at a particular time. It may be against the grain of public opinion to argue that refugees need more help than they are currently being offered. That does not mean such an argument is wrong. Indeed, it actually makes it more urgent. In the past, our laws repressed LGBT people with the approval of much of the population. LGBT activists had to confront not just their own governments, but public opinion as well. Last year, Ireland voted decisively to support equal marriage. Working class communities were often the most enthusiastic in putting their votes behind equality. But although the outcome was beneficial for minority rights, was the method of achieving it right? I would argue not. Should a majority be consulted via a referendum as to whether a minority should have the same rights as they did? If the outcome had been different, would the denial of equal rights of a minority at the behest of a majority really constitute democracy? Now, 4 months ago, as I've said, Britain voted to leave the European Union, and that democratic decision must be respected and implemented. The debate now is about the form Brexit takes, not whether it takes place at all. That does not mean the 48% who voted for Remain should be treated like a vanquished army, a routed internal opposition deprived of a say over the future of their own country, to be mocked and reviled as Ramoners. Rather than a democracy of conquerors, we need a democracy now more than ever of deliberation. Now, as a socialist humanist, I believe in collective solutions to collective problems. But collectivism doesn't have to mean conformity. As Mills put it, human nature is not a machine to be built after a model and set to do exactly the work prescribed to it, but a tree which requires to grow and develop on all sides according to the tendency of the inward forces which make it a living thing. Collectivism is often presented as the enemy of the individual, depriving her or him of autonomy, responsibility, and the rewards of effort. But a socialist humanist believes otherwise. Jean Jaurès was the humanist founder of the French Socialist Party. He was assassinated in 1914 for opposing Europe's death march towards the calamity of the Great War. For Jaurès, building a society based on cooperation would extend the rights and the potential of the individual. Individualism was at the very core of his socialism. And this is absolutely right. Collective security gives the individual the potential to flourish. Collectively provided education allows the talent of the individual to be developed. One of the unspoken consequences of the trebling of tuition fees, which is where, not the trebling, but the introduction is where we first met, Andrew, but the trebling of tuition fees, which transforms a social good into a product for individual consumers, has been a collapse in the number of part-time students. Over 150,000 fewer part-time students since the trebling of those tuition fees just a few years ago. Overwhelmingly, these are adults, disproportionately from working class backgrounds, who want a second chance to realise their potential. As Will Hutton puts it, taken together with a fall in the number of mature students doing full-time degrees, this represents one of the biggest setbacks to social mobility in modern times. We could go on. Poverty and poor housing damages the prospects and happiness of the individual. They require collective solutions. The self-employed entrepreneur relies on state-funded infrastructure from road to rail, on publicly provided research and development which can be appropriated for innovation, and some level of social security so they can take risks without fear of penury. The needs of the individual are facilitated, not undermined, by collectivism. Now, human freedom is imperiled by economic constraints. Poverty limits the choices an individual can make, like living in warmth, having a house that provides comfort as well as shelter, having regular holidays, inviting your children's friends round for dinner. It robs the individual of security and therefore freedom. An individual who lies awake, staring at the ceiling in the early hours, wondering how they will pay a gas bill, is not free. An individual driven to a legal loan shark to pay the rent or put food on the table is not free. An individual who is told it's 7 a.m. whether they have any hours at work that day is not free. Consider the society we live in. It is the sixth richest economy on earth, was the fifth richest economy on earth until Theresa May made a speech at Conservative Party conference. Now, the wealth of the richest 1,000 people has more than doubled in the last few years, even during one of the great economic traumas in the modern history of this nation. And at the same time, workers have suffered the longest fall in their wages since Queen Victoria sat on the throne in the 19th century. At least half of people in poverty are in work. These are people who get up in the morning and earn their poverty day after day after day. Hundreds of thousands of our fellow citizens are driven to food banks to satisfy the most basic human need of all, other than breathing and drinking water, to eat. In one of the richest societies that has ever existed on the face of the earth. In London, where I now live as a plastic sellout northerner, one of the wealthiest cities on earth, millions of people, not just in London, hundreds of thousands of people languish in social housing waiting lists, as luxury flats are left vacant, whilst one in four children grow up in an overcrowded home, damaging their health, their education, and their well-being as well. According to the Institute of Fiscal Studies, child poverty is set to surge by 50% in the coming years. As humanists, we treasure human life above all else. And yet in our poorest areas, life expectancy is significantly lower than in the most affluent. If you travel east on London's Jubilee Line, life expectancy falls by 1 year with every station that you pass. Our aspiration must be a society that puts human need and aspiration before short-term profit. The wealth of our societies is a collective endeavour. That must be reflected by how it is distributed. The concentration of wealth in so few hands insults the collective contribution that creates it. We all suffer as well. The failure to unlock an individual's potential is a loss to society as a whole. Now, humanism needs answer to the often dehumanising nature of modern work as well. A young Karl Marx, in his mid-twenties, he offered some compelling answers. Marxism has often been dismissed as economic determinism, or vulgar Marxism, as it is sometimes called, where all social and political phenomena are reduced to their economic relations. Marxism was infamously distorted to justify some of the most murderous regimes humanity has ever known. In 1956, Peter Fryer, then a journalist working for the British Communist Party's newspaper, The Weekly Worker, was sent to Hungary to report on its revolution against Stalinist oppression. He was expected to toe the Soviet line. His experiences drove him to reject the monstrous lies that underpinned it. Stalinism is Marxism with a heart cut out, he wrote. Dehumanised, dried, frozen, petrified, rigid, barren. Even in his own time, Karl Marx was driven to reject those who misappropriated his work, declaring, "Je ne suis pas un marxiste, I'm not a Marxist." But in his economic and philosophical manuscripts, written in 1984, Marx wrote of how the worker is alienated from their own labour, which is appropriated by their bosses. Estrangement from their own labour, he argued, robbed them of their own humanity. Labour is external to the worker, he wrote. It does not belong to his intrinsic nature. That is his work. Therefore, he does not affirm himself, but denies himself, does not feel content, but unhappy, does not develop freely his physical and mental energy, but mortifies his body and ruins his mind. He feels at home when he is not working, and when he is working, he does not feel at home. His labour is therefore not voluntary. It is therefore not the satisfaction of a need. It is merely a means to satisfy needs external to it. Now, not long after the Wall Street crash, John Maynard Keynes, the economist, he suggested that by now, in 2016, we would only be working 15 hours a week. Now, if you're a full-time worker in Britain, on average, you put in nearly 28 hours more than that, so we haven't quite managed that. Now, we dedicate so much of our waking life in the service of others. The casualisation of labour, such as the growth of 0 hours and agency work, robs workers of rights and security and places them ever more at the mercy of the whims of their employers. Self-employed people often value their independence in this country, but not their insecurity. They earn less than they did 20 years ago, often lack sufficient social security, such as paid leave, can struggle to get credit from banks, and are often chasing unpaid invoices. The right to security at work is a struggle that we have fought in this and other countries for many generations, and we have to fight it again. Giving workers more of a voice in their own workplaces should be another priority, but we should surely fight as well for a better balance between work and the rest of our lives. As Nick Sinich and Alex Williams point out in their compelling work, The Future of Work, while technology in the past created more jobs than it destroyed, it may now be the other way around. As the Times columnist and former Blair speechwriter Philip Collins highlights, there's research suggesting that in the course of the next two decades, up to 60% of retail jobs, retail being one of the biggest employers in the country, may become automated. 11 million jobs overall, he says, as this research shows, could disappear. Not just skilled and unskilled blue-collar jobs, as in the past, but this time, middle-class professional jobs as well. And here's an opportunity, though, as well as a challenge. With work becoming more precarious, instead of consigning people to ever greater insecurity and writing off a large chunk of the workforce as effectively surplus to requirements, let's consider how we can rebalance our lives. That's why a universal basic income as a right of citizenship has such potential, giving all of us more freedom to work less and spend more time watching our children grow up, loving our partners, playing sports, expanding our cultural horizons. Now, as well as economic rights, we face a battle in this country now for political human rights as well. The Human Rights Act embodies rights and freedoms our ancestors fought for in this country at great cost and great sacrifice over many, many generations. Like a fair trial, like freedom of expression and religion, like the right to marry and start a family. It is an act that enshrines in law the European Convention on Human Rights of 1951. One of its key drafters was Sir David Maxwell Fyfe, a conservative lawyer who served under Winston Churchill. The proposed repeal of this act is an attack on human rights that weren't given to us, but were fought for by our ancestors at such cost. But for humanists, basic rights aren't enough. We don't just want to survive, we want to live. The worker must have bread, as the American trade unionist Rose Schneiderman put it, but she must have roses too. That's what underpinned the agenda of the humanist Clement Attlee as his government sought to transform a Britain ruined by World War II. His Festival of Britain in 1951 showcased art, architecture, science and so-called pleasure gardens. There was so much that was austere and dour about post-war Britain. Here was an attempt to focus on building a country that wasn't just about providing jobs, housing and security for its people, as important, of course, as that was, but so much more. Life needs colour as well as warmth. There was much to criticise the last Labour government for, but it was in this vein that it introduced free entry to museums and art galleries. A humanist society must surely promote free and varied cultural expression, accessible to everybody. We aspire to societies that nurture well-rounded individuals. As Bertrand Russell put it, the happy life is to an extraordinary extent the same as a good life. Now, one of the pillars of a free, open and humane society is, of course, secularism. It is an objective that our ancestors have been long persecuted for, including, of course, George Holyoake, after whom this very lecture was named, and as Andrew says, who coined the term secularism, and who was imprisoned for his activism and his campaigning. Organised religion has no place in the affairs of the state, and vice versa. It is for the good of both state and religion to separate both. That means a state that protects the right of the individual to religious conviction, but a state that expresses no preference for any. Britain is still the only country in the democratic world where clerics have an automatic right to sit in our legislature. This vestige of theocracy must surely be written out of our constitution. As humanists, we deplore the plans of this current government to expand faith schools, further segregating our children by the religious convictions of their parents. Much like grammar schools, these faith schools take in fewer poorer children than their non-segregated equivalents. Schools, whether they are faith-based or not, are expected to promote religious worship too amongst our pupils, an anachronism in our modern society. Now, as an atheist, though, and this is an important point, as an atheist, I don't have religious faith, but I don't have contempt for those who do. There is an aggressive form of atheism that simplistically reduces the world's many problems to religious belief, and which treats believers and belief, however moderate, with contempt. I don't think that's conducive to a harmonious society and can often lead to bigotry. People of faith have made astonishing contributions in our society, and indeed British socialism owes much to the contribution of progressive Christians. Today, people of faith are instrumental in supporting those condemned otherwise by government policy. Food banks, for example, are frequently organised by those with strongly held religious convictions. Indeed, a secular society must defend its minorities. Today, there are all too many British Jews who feel threatened in modern Britain, including in progressive circles. There are those who would never dream, on the left, of dismissing the lived experience of Muslims or black people, who treat all claims of anti-Semitism as a means to shut down opposition to the occupation of Palestine. Sinister tropes with a heritage going back hundreds of years are indulged of Jews wielding sinister, secretive, global influence. There are all too many British Jews I know personally, none of whom could be accused of being apologists for the actions of the Israeli government or even close, who feel genuine fear. Their voices must be listened to. Anti-Semitism is a sickness, and it must be driven from our society forever. Now, there's another minority which faces mounting hatred. In the 1930s, infamously again, the principal target of Europe's far right were Jews. Today, it's Muslims. Muslims are increasingly portrayed, and not just by the far right, as a menacing enemy within. Polling in Britain has suggested that approaching half of our fellow citizens believe there are too many Muslims in this country. The research also suggests that millions of Britons regard Muslims as being synonymous with extremism and having beliefs that are incompatible with democracy. There are those who say this to me, and they tweet this to me every other week, sometimes every other day. Owen, you're a gay man. How can you possibly defend Muslims? Now, I know such bigoted detractors only ever mention LGBT rights when the cause can be appropriated to make negative sweeping generalisations about Muslims. Much the same, of course, with women's rights as well. And I have to say, even though I am a traitor to the North, I'm proud to live now in a city which elected a Muslim mayor who joined other fellow Muslim Labour members of Parliament in a free parliamentary vote to support equal marriage for people like me, in stark contrast to the majority of Conservative MPs. But there is no question at all, that Muslims are increasingly portrayed in this country and across the Western world, most notably, of course, in the United States with the demagogic campaign of Donald Trump, who uses rhetoric about Muslims that this continent politicians used about Jews in the 1930s. That Muslims are increasingly portrayed as a threat to secular, liberal European values. In the 19th century, it was said that anti-Semitism was the socialism of fools. And what was meant by that was this, that it was appropriated socialism, if you like, or anti-Semitism. Anti-Semitism appropriated leftist rhetoric about financiers and unaccountable elites to direct hatred against Jewish people. Today it could be said that Islamophobia is the secularism of fools, the misappropriation of the great cause of separating state and religion to steer bigotry against an entire group of humanity. And to be clear, so there's no misunderstanding, by Islamophobia, I mean prejudice and bigotry against Muslims. It's also what the extremists want us to do. Nicolas Hinin is a Frenchman who was imprisoned by ISIS. In the aftermath of the Bataclan atrocity back in November, that dark November last year, Hinin wrote the following. With their news and social media interest, they, ISIS, will be noting everything that follows their murderous assault on Paris. And my guess is that right now, the chant among them will be, "We are winning." They will be heartened by every sign of overreaction, of division, of fear, of racism, of xenophobia. They will be drawn to any examples of ugliness on social media. Central to their worldview is the belief that communities, he said, cannot live together with Muslims. And every day their antennae will be tuned towards finding supporting evidence. The pictures from Germany of people welcoming migrants will have been particularly troubling to them. He ends, cohesion, tolerance, it is not what they want to see. When the extremists launch atrocities, they wield a script they expect us to follow. They want us to express hatred and bigotry. They want us to turn on each other. It is the reiteration of our common humanity that repulses them the most. Now, as a gay man, I'm a member of a group that has suffered systematic oppression and hatred for centuries. It would be repellent to use the oppression of my group to fuel the oppression of another. And standing up against the hatred Muslims face is not only the right thing to do, it can build alliances to overcome all forms of bigotry. Earlier this year, a young man got in touch with me. He said to me this: gay was a proper scary word growing up in a Muslim family. It was only when my family found out you were gay that it completely broke the stereotype that existed in their minds. It gave me the courage to finally come out. You showed them something on my behalf that I never ever could, that gay doesn't define me. Not saying things are all rosy now or anything, but just overcoming that hurdle meant I've got to where I am today. LGBT people expressing their solidarity with Muslims is infinitely more effective at overcoming barriers than indulging bigotry will ever be. Now, we live, as I've said, in an age of insecurity, fear, of bigotries and deceit that are indulged, of rights and freedoms that are imperiled. Amid so much gloom, humanism, I think, is a light. Building societies that maximise human freedom and well-being, which allow us to freely develop our potential unencumbered, which emphasise our common humanity rather than the artificial barriers that divide us. These are aspirations we must and have a responsibility to realise. It will be a struggle, but social change always is. In the decades before us, future generations will look back at these turbulent and difficult times, and they will ask us what we did. Our history abounds with great humanists who helped build a society that were more free, just, creative, and informed, like Marie Curie and William Beveridge, like Mary Wollstonecraft and Clement Attlee, like George Eliot and Stephen Hawking. Here is a tradition we should feel proud to stand in. It will mean courage, determination, and resilience. The illusion of every age is that it will last forever. Many of the noble aims of humanism may seem imperiled today, but this age too will pass. A politics of humanism can help build a world that is free, just, and equal. It's not inevitable, but it is necessary. And every single one of us here has a role in creating it. Thank you.
What was your final word? Thank you very much, Owen. Thank you very much.